Please be invited to worship as we pray the Litany Prayer. Come out of your busy lives to a quiet time and place. Come and rest in the Lord, who will restore your souls. Come and find the quiet center. Come be at peace. Amen. At this time, we are invited to welcome one another with signs of grace and peace. I'm Pastor Jeannie Martin Dudenhofer, one of the pastors here, and honored to be a pastor here. And so glad you're in worship with us today. If you're guests, we're especially glad you're here. If you're joining us on the television or through internet, streaming live, or podcast later on, we're glad you're a part of our worshiping congregation as well. Please greet one another. Christ's peace rest on your spirit. Peace, friend. Seated. At this time, we are inviting children to go to the door. There's Grace to greet you. Adults, if you have not signed your children in for children's worship, please do so at this time. They're learning about at the zoo this summer, and this time up are the parrots. So find out what the kingdom of God and parrots have to do with each other. We have some announcements for you at this time. Our guest organist, Wolfgang Reisinger, will be in this worship service next Sunday, as well as in the Saturday night service, and will present a recital at 1:30 next Sunday. We hope that many of you will be present for this offering of beautiful music. As you see, we have quite the mountains here of toilet paper. There were mountains all over the place last Sunday, but now we have only the two. And it looks like the adults edged out the kiddos a little bit. In any case, these mountains will be a great blessing to our guests, whom we will plan to start welcoming in September with our Fresh Start Market Dignity Pantry. We're hoping to develop relationships with neighbors around being able to supply essential needs. And finally, if you've not registered for the Global Leadership Summit, there's still time to do that. And there's a code. You can find that at the homepage, jcfumc.org. And we have a video that talks about the essential nature of this training.
I'm Marianne Wood. My husband Rick and I are the faculty advisors to a student-led ministry called Breakaway at Northfield Mount Hermon School. My husband became the chief financial officer for the school in 2002. Shortly after that, we experienced Leadership Summit, and we were listening to one of Bill Hybels' teachings on what leaders do. Bill Hybels said, "Leaders create movement toward a goal." And I thought, okay, I can do that. He said they ignite activity, they catalyze new levels of commitment and energize people. Then he talked about how a leader must step up and lead, get elbow deep in the ministry, vision cast, cheerlead tirelessly. I thought, I can do that. But who, how, where, what? Then Bill said, just ask. Ask a potential leader to come with you to see one time what God is doing. So I asked one student, Heather, to go with me down to Deerfield Academy, a neighboring boarding school, to see what God was doing there. Heather and I went, and the following Wednesday, Heather invited Andy, Sarah, and Emily to go too. Before long, we were filling up the van on Wednesday nights and praying that God would do at Northfield Mount Hermon School what he was doing at Deerfield Academy. God provided, and we set a date for our first event here in our home with a big supper, and we invited the entire school. What you need to understand is that these students have been sent here from all over the world to work to get into top universities and colleges. They're under a lot of pressure to succeed. And so what I want to do is to create a place, a home, where they can experience joy, grace, love. It's so rewarding to see these kids grow, to see them take the ministry and move it forward. Breakaway has arms and legs and feet. It's forward moving, it's dynamic, and the kids own it. That's exciting for me. I keep coming back to the summit because I'm hungry to get better. The summit fuels my life and my ministry. Am I a leader? I'm a servant. I'm an encourager. I'm a cheerleader. I hope I'm a reflection of Jesus Christ to these teens. If that makes me a leader, then I guess I am.
I don't mind if you've got something nice to say about me, and I enjoy an accolade like the rest. And you could take my picture and hang it in a gallery of all the who's who's and so-and-so's that used to be the best at such and such. It wouldn't matter much. I won't lie, it feels all right to see your name in lights. We all need an attaboy or attagirl. But in the end, I like to hang my hat on more besides the temporary trappings of this world. I want to leave a legacy. How will they remember me? Did I choose to love? Did I point to you enough to make a mark on things? Wanna bring an offering? Child of mercy and grace, who blessed your name unapologetically, and leave that kind of legacy. I don't have to look too far or too long a while to make a lengthy list of all that I enjoy. It's an accumulating trinket and a treasure pile where moss and rust, thieves and such would soon enough destroy. I want to leave a legacy. How will they remember me? Did I choose to love? Did I point to you enough to make a mark on things? Wanna bring an offering, a child of mercy and grace, who blessed your name unapologetically. I leave that kind of legacy. Not well traveled, not well read, not well to do or well bred. I just wanna hear instead, well done, good and faithful one. Hey, yeah. Oh, I wanna leave a legacy. How will they remember me? Did I choose to love? Did I point to you enough to make a mark on things? Wanna bring an offering, a child of mercy and grace, who blessed your name unapologetically. And leave that kind of legacy. I don't mind if you've got something nice to say about me.
The scripture for today comes from Luke 10:38-42. Now as they went on their way, he entered a certain village, where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. It is wonderful to have you here this morning. Welcome to our 11 o'clock worship at First United Methodist Church. My name is Daniel Hilty, one of the pastors here. I get to share in our sermon time with us this morning, and I'm very grateful for that and happy about that. I know it's been raining a lot out there this morning. Was it raining when you all came in today? Okay, good. I'm glad it's kind of died down. We have a lot of beautiful, wonderful things happening inside this morning. I'm so grateful to Emily Myers for leading our hymns. So thank you so much to Emily and Bill Lehman. As always, a wonderful job on the organ and the piano. Ryan Hampton is gone this week on Wesley Choir tour. And someone else that fills in when one of our regulars is gone is Quentin Rice on the audio-video box back there when Tom is gone, and so we're grateful for Quentin, too. For them and for you, we give thanks to God, especially if you're visiting this morning. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Whatever brought you here, we pray that you have a sense of God's presence and the Spirit's love for you in these moments. Welcome to those of you watching on the TV and those on the internet. You are a blessing and a gift, and we pray for a sense of God's Spirit with you today as well. Jeannie and I were joking. I'm glad that Jeannie waits to mention the toilet paper until the children are dismissed for children's worship this morning. You know, we've been kind of building it up as a big competition, right, over the last couple weeks between the kids and the adults. And now that the adults actually kind of have sort of beaten the kids, I feel kind of guilty about it. It seems kind of awkward. Kind of wish I hadn't built it up so much. But they still did great, right? And who wouldn't say this is still a great mountain, right? So we're grateful for everyone who's brought in the toilet paper for the Fresh Start Market. Thank you so much. As we begin the sermon time, I want to ask you to please join with me in a moment of prayer. Let's pray. Oh God, we bring many offerings to you this hour. We offer you, oh God, our joys. We offer you our hopes. We offer you maybe unexpected good news or visitors from the last week. We offer you this morning as well, oh God, our hurts, our fears. We lift to you the hurts and the fears of the world. We remember those who are grieving, especially this morning in Chattanooga, following another shooting. We pray, O Lord, for those who are grieving in our own community, who have lost parents or loved ones. Lord, we ask that you would receive all of these joys and all of these hurts and all of these hopes and all of these fears. Receive them all as our offering to you. Use them, O God. Use them to help us to grow in the love and faith and hope of Jesus Christ. Fill us with your Spirit, O Lord, that we may serve you faithfully and joyfully in the world. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. So today we reach the end of our Be Still series. And if you've been here over the last few weeks, you may remember that the point of the Be Still series is to try to help us find God's peace in the midst of our busy lives or our messy lives. And as the last sermon in the series today, I'd like it if we could begin the sermon time with a little fun. You want to do a little fun this morning? Okay, good. All right. On the screen right now, on the screen is a little girl who is attempting a form of multitasking, doing two things at one time, which sometimes sounds easy, but actually is pretty hard. Anybody want to guess as to what specifically this girl is attempting to do? That's right. I see some modeling it. That's right. She's patting her head and she is rubbing her belly at the same time, right? Patting your head and rubbing your tummy at the same time is the nemesis of children everywhere. Many children find this to be very, very difficult. But of course, it's not just difficult for children, right? Even some of us adults have a hard time with this. And so, you know where this is going. And so, to help us appreciate just what a challenging multitasking feat this is, I'm going to invite us to give it a try. Now, you don't have to do this, all right? If you feel uncomfortable doing this, you don't have to. If you don't feel physically able to do it, you don't have to. That's totally okay. Your job is you can just sit there and laugh at the rest of us, okay? But if you feel comfortable, let's give it a try. Please put one hand on top of your head, all right? Oh, you're great, you're great. Please put your other hand on your belly. Don't start yet, but when I say go, pat your head and rub your belly. Are you ready? Okay, go. Pat your head, rub your belly, pat your head, rub your belly. You guys are so good. I love my job so much. Okay, switch. Oh, I know, it's tricky, right? Yeah, pat your head, rub your belly. Okay, you're good. You can stop. Thank you. Thank you so much. All right, that was great. So how many of you found that, you know, at least a little bit hard, kind of tricky, a little bit tricky? What about when we switched? Was that kind of, yeah, it takes a second, right? It takes a second where you have to think, am I supposed to pat? Am I supposed to rub? What am I supposed to do? So, some of you may be asking, Daniel, what was the point of that, right? What is the point of rubbing our heads and patting our tummies or patting our heads and rubbing our, I can't even do it, in worship? Does it have anything to do with the sermon? And the answer is, nah, not really. I just wanted to see if you would do it, right? And it was, no, I'm joking. There is a point, and the point is this. The point is that multitasking is not easy. Multitasking is not easy. Some of you may be familiar with this term, multitasking. It first made its appearance about 60 years ago. It was coined to refer to machines that could do more than two tasks at the same time. And then in the mid-1960s, the term came to be applied to computers. And then finally, in the late 1990s, the term made the jump from computers to human beings. And around 1998, we started referring to people as multitaskers. Whatever people do two things at one time, we say that they are multitasking, kind of like, you know, patting our head and rubbing our belly at the same time. The classic workplace example is, trying to talk on the phone and answer your email at the same time, too, right? That's an example of multitasking. Now, if I were to take a random sampling of the population of the United States, including the folks in this room, including myself, my understanding is that most people would say they think they are okay multitaskers, right? Most people would say that, you know, they may not be the best multitaskers in the world, but they're not the worst multitaskers either. It's kind of like the old Jeff Foxworthy joke, who says that the one thing all Americans have in common, the one thing that unites us all, is that we all believe we are slightly better than average drivers, right? It's the one thing that we all think. Well, we all believe we're kind of slightly better than average multitaskers. We may not be great at it, but at least we're better than this guy over here, right? Or this gal, or whoever. But what science has shown again and again, what studies have shown again and again, is that that's just not true. And study after study after study, researchers have found that multitasking is not easy for anybody. We're just not wired for it as human beings. In fact, often it's impossible. Often it's an illusion. And we're just fooling ourselves to think that we can really multitask. And consequently, we human beings are not nearly as good at it as we think we might be. Now, I should say, I do need to tell you, that there have been a few studies which seem to indicate that women may be slightly better multitaskers than men. Yeah, I know. We kind of all know that already, don't we, deep down inside? So go women. Women may be slightly better multitaskers than men, which is really interesting. That may actually explain why we men have such trouble sometimes switching our brains quickly between one subject or another. It reminds me of a side story about, never mind, I lost it. Anyway, though, you know, the point is that none of us, whether women or men, are very good at doing two things at once, like patting our head and rubbing our belly. And when we try to do it, we often just mess things up all the more, especially when we try to multitask people. Paul Limley, our minister to students, Paul Lemmy, once told me about a Human Performance Institute workshop he attended where the speaker, he said, made a great point. She said her main point was that we should never try to multitask people because we'll always eventually mess it up in the end. Even though we think we can, the truth is that we can't. And if you've ever been around somebody who's tried to multitask you, you know what I'm talking about, right? You know how it feels. Maybe they're talking with you, but they're also kind of like, you know, checking their phone, right? Or they're just kind of looking just slightly past you, right? Like over your shoulder. Or you can just tell they're thinking about something else, right? They're with you, but you can tell their mind is somewhere else, thinking about something else. Anybody ever experience that? Yeah. When someone tries to multitask you, it doesn't feel very good, does it? I mean, we've all experienced that. I suspect we've all done it, too. I know that I have more often than I care to admit. I do more often than I care to admit. I mean, actually, people have always tried to multitask other people. It's just we haven't had a name for it until recently. We didn't have the word multitasking. Today's scripture reading is an example of it, even from Bible times. Luke 10 tells us about this, you know, this really interesting story where Jesus is walking through this town one day, and he decides that he wants to stop in and see his two friends, Mary and Martha, who are sisters. And so he stops by the house of Mary and Martha. And pretty quickly after he arrives, Mary and Martha start to play two very different roles. Mary, we're told, Mary just sat at Jesus' feet and listened to him, right? Just kind of hung out and listened to what Jesus had to say. But Martha was distracted by her what? That's right, her many tasks. Many tasks, which is as close as you can get in Bible speak to multitask, right? Many tasks is Bible speak for multitask. Martha was trying to multitask, and she was trying to multitask Jesus in the middle of all of that, and she was distracted by it. And Jesus even says so in the next verse. He says, Martha, Martha, you're distracted by so many things, and there's need of only one thing. And Mary has chosen the better part. It's as if Jesus is saying the same thing that speaker from the workshop that Paul attended was saying. Jesus is saying to Martha, you know, Martha, you can't multitask people. You can't multitask me. I know you may think you can, but you can't. Scientists have proven it. They've done this research and study, Martha, and, you know, Bible scientists or whatever, that you just can't do it. And since you can't, since we're physically not able to multitask, why don't you just focus on the one task that matters the most right now? Which is just being present with each other. Now, does that mean, I know that Martha always seems to get a bad rap in this, and we always feel bad for Martha. Does that mean that, you know, Martha's other tasks or other jobs weren't important? Well, no, of course it doesn't mean that. But maybe they weren't what was, you know, what was most important in that moment for a little bit. I mean, and you see, when we want to spend time with someone, when spending time with someone is on our agenda, when it's a priority for the day, whether it's a friend or a spouse or a child or a parent or a stranger or Jesus or God, the greatest gift we can give in that relationship is just to truly be present to that other person, to be fully present to that person. And there's only one way to do that. There's only one way to be fully present to that other person. And that is, you know, just for a moment or two to set everything else aside, to set the distractions aside, even if it's just for a minute. In other words, this passage teaches us that maybe the greatest gift any of us can give in a relationship is what Mary gives to Jesus in this passage, and that is our undivided attention, right? Our undivided attention. Our undivided attention is one of the greatest gifts we can give in any of the relationships that matter most to us, relationships with our family or with our friends or with Jesus or even with God, even with God. Because really, if we want to grow in relationship with God, if we want to discover God's peace in the midst of our lives, it means giving God our undivided attention from time to time in moments of prayer or worship or silence or service. So how do we do this, right? How do we go about giving our undivided attention in the relationships that matter to us the most? Well, our scripture reading today offers us three suggestions toward doing that. First of all, when we want to give our undivided attention to God or to Jesus or to other people, maybe the most important step is to set aside the distractions. That's what Jesus talks about with Martha, right? He says, Martha, you're troubled with many tasks, you're multitasking, set all that aside for a moment and just come and spend time with me. Now, what distractions may be present in your life? It can be different from what may be present in the life of the person next to you, but just think for a moment. What are those distractions in your life that maybe get in the way of being fully present in a relationship, the relationships that matter most to you with God, with Jesus, with the people in your life? Even though they may be different, each one of us, I suspect there may be some common themes. I mean, maybe we might set aside a distraction by leaving our phones in the other room, right, while we spend time with this person we want to spend time with. Or maybe we can even turn them off, right, for a little bit. Or maybe we can turn off the TV for a moment, or music, or we can just ask God to help us give our undivided attention in these relationships, and just for a little bit, to help us stop worrying about the future, worrying about the past. That's one of the biggies for me that takes me away from being present. Secondly, we want to give our undivided attention to someone. Our scripture reading tells us that it's also, you know, helpful to focus a lot more on listening and a lot less on talking. And that's what Mary does in our scripture reading, right? Verse 39 says that she sits at Jesus' feet, and she does what? She listens. It's the only thing we're told that she does. Mary just sits there, and she listens. And so if we want to give our undivided attention to someone, it means that we listen too. In our relationship with God, that means that when we pray, our prayers aren't just us talking all the time, but also just taking some time to listen and see if God has anything to say back. And listening to others means that our first priority when we want to spend some quality time with them is not necessarily to try to fix their problems, not necessarily to try to give them advice or find a way to talk about ourselves, but instead just to hear how they're feeling about their life right now. And when we do talk, we can use even those words to communicate listening. We can ask them questions to help us understand them better, or to let them know that we're glad they're in their life, they're in our life, and that we care for them. And then finally, our scripture reading today teaches us that if we want to give our undivided attention in a relationship, it means valuing quality of time as much as quantity of time. You know, that there's no indication in our scripture reading that Mary just gave up all of her responsibilities forever, right, in order to spend some undivided time with Jesus. In fact, if you go on in our scripture reading, you'll find the very next verse says that Jesus moved on, and he went on to another town and another place, and he started doing something else. He started teaching his disciples about prayer. And the same is safe to assume for Mary, I think, that very quickly after that time together, she moved on to her other responsibilities in the rest of her life too. In other words, what made the time Mary spent with Jesus so important is not the number of minutes she spent with Jesus, but the undivided attention that she gave him in those moments together. When we want to give our undivided attention to someone, the quality of time matters as much as the quantity of time, maybe even more. I mean, think about it like this. You know, even just 10 minutes, maybe even just 5 minutes with a friend, when they give us their focused, undivided attention, I mean, that can help us to feel so much more loved and cared for than spending even 30 minutes with that same friend while they're distracted, right, or where they're busy, and we feel like we're just interrupting them and we're in their way and, you know, all of that. Have you ever had anybody in your life, who is it in your life that helped you feel that in that instant, you were the most important person in the world to them? I mean, intellectually, you might, you know, of course, that you might not be the most important person in the world to them, but in that instant, they made you feel like that, right? In that instant of undivided attention. Those are the moments we're talking about. Those moments are made not by quantity of time, but by quality of time. And so what does that mean for us? It means that if we're feeling distracted, if we're feeling busy or rushed, and we don't feel like we can afford much time for the other people in our lives, you know, maybe we're having a really busy day, and maybe we have kids, and if our kids come up to us and want to spend some time with us, and we feel like, you know, we just don't have the time in the midst of all of our chores and all of the work, what it means is that maybe even just a little bit of quality time of undivided focused attention can do a world of good. And I know it's something that I face and struggle with in my own relationship with my own family and children especially. But, you know, even 10 minutes of just setting aside everything else and looking that other person in the eye and really listening to them goes so much further to helping them feel loved than if we spend 30 minutes of only half listening, right? Or we're also still trying to watch the game, or we're still trying to catch the news, or we're still trying to finish the sermon, right, or whatever. And the same is true in our relationship with God. We may be surprised just how much 10 minutes of undivided attention toward God can do to our relationship with God. as opposed to 30 minutes of trying to multitask God along with TV or music or work or anything else. See, the truth is that there may be some things in life where we can kind of do this, right? Where we can sort of pat our heads and rub our bellies at the same time. There may be some things that we can sort of multitask in life, but there are other things, important things, that we just can't. Like relationships. Our relationships with God and with Jesus and with people are far too important to multitask because, honestly, we just can't do it very well. We're not wired to do it very well. And so the invitation this week is simply to practice a moment or two of undivided attention in those relationships that matter the most to us this week. For just a moment or two this week, leave the phone in another room, turn off the TV, set the bills aside, and just listen and just be present and just look that other person in the eyes. It doesn't even have to be a long time very much in terms of minutes. What matters is that it's undivided time, because when we give our undivided time to someone, to God or to Jesus or to someone else that we care about, we're giving the very best gift that we can. By the grace of God, we really are choosing the better part that will never be taken away from us. And to help us do that, there is a closing prayer that you will find printed on the screen. I invite you to please pray with me. Oh God, help me this week to give frequent moments of my undivided attention to you and to the people you have put in my life. Let me set aside my distractions that I may listen for your voice. In Christ's name, amen.
And we take a moment now to shift our focus to the gift of this sacrament, a focus for our faith, indeed a mystery, but Christ Jesus' gift to us for all the times when nothing else will do. We have the body and blood of Christ given for us. You have some instructions on the back of your worship bulletin. We would like you to take a look at those. In the United Methodist Church here at First Church, we traditionally take communion by intinction, which means taking a piece of the bread and dipping it in the cup. We also have gluten-free elements in the silver trays on either side table, and individual cups should you choose to use one. The liturgy will be printed on the screen, or you can follow in your hymnal on pages 13 and 14. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Christ Jesus, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until we feast at your heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever, as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth forth in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As you are directed by the ushers, won't you come? Because all things are ready, and the gifts of God are for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Friends, let us pray together. Holy God, even as you have given yourself for us, even as we have taken you in and feel empowered by your love, bless us as we go forth to focus on those whom God has given us. Lead us now and always to be your church, to shine a light in the darkest corners in this world, and to love our neighbor as we love ourselves by the power of your Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, you're invited to give your offerings, your tithes. You're invited to return to Christ Jesus a little bit of the bounty of what has been given to you. And so the ushers will come forward and take our offering this morning.
Will you please stand? Pray. Let us pray. Oh God, all that we are, all that we have are gifts from you, and we are grateful. We pray that you would use this offering as a sign of our thanksgiving for the work of Jesus Christ in our community, in ourselves, in our church, around the world. We pray through your Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, I want to share with us a couple of pieces of bittersweet news. We are saying goodbye to three dear folks today, and we're going to say goodbye with a farewell blessing to the Wests right after our hymn. But before the hymn, we are going to send our summer intern, Aneed, off with our blessing and our care. Some of you know, most of us know, that Aneed has been serving among us so well this last summer. And today is her last Sunday with us. And so Jeannie is here to share our blessing and our love.
Even though we've said this to her in three services, she continues to be surprised because we've given her three different Bibles. Last night, The Message, which is a contemporary English version. In the first service today, a children's storybook Bible. And now, Una Santa Biblia in Español. And we send her forth to the ministry that God is going to enable her to do. I know that she's brought a lot of leaven to the loaf. She's been salt of the earth among us this summer. And we're very grateful to God for her. Would you pray with me? Oh God, we send forth Aneed, thanking you for the blessing that she's been to us and believing that you'll continue to work a mighty work in her life, in her final year of college and beyond. Oh God, pave the path before her that she might walk it faithfully in Jesus' name. Vai con Dios, amiga.
Thank you.
Thank you. I hope you'll have an opportunity to tell Anid your own personal greeting after the service. For now, though, let's remain standing. We're going to sing our closing hymn, and then after the closing hymn, we give our final farewell blessing to Arvid and Barbara West. But for now, let's join together in our closing hymn. It is number 582 in the hymnal, Whom Shall I Send? Standing, we offer one final farewell blessing. Many of us know and love well Arvid and Barbara West. They were telling me that they have been around this church either as visitors or members for 23 years.
It took us 10 years to decide.
So 10 years to visit, and then after 10 years they decided, you know what? This is an okay place. And at 13 years as members and faithful and wonderful members, I know that I can personally attest that I am blessed every time I get to talk with them. And I know that so many of you can attest to that as well. So they are moving out of the community. They're not moving too far. They're moving to Fenton, to Fenton, to be closer to family. So that's saying something. You got a good daughter. Can move in and still be friends. Well, yes.
I would like to say that we really enjoyed, we love this church and you all. And it's seeing Reverend Daniel Hilty, I met as they were wheeling me in for surgery in St. Mary's. I mean, it's a great time to meet your preacher. It's really been wonderful being with you, and Barbara and I really look forward to these Sundays we've been able to get here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Will you please join with me in giving thanks to God for Arvid and Barbara? And then sending them off with a prayer that we all have a part of, and I will begin with the part of the leader. Friends, the church is a family. United by Christ, we are all brothers and sisters, and for a time, this church, First United Methodist Church, is our home. Like every family, our church family is formed and reformed over time as members are born, as they die, as they are adopted into our family, and as they leave our congregation for a new home. For a time, Arvid and Barbara have lived with us. God has blessed us through them, and we have worshiped God together and shared each other's joys and sorrows. Now they prepare to leave for a new home, and so we join together, all of us together, to pray God's blessing upon them. O God,
we entrust Arvid and Barbara into your hands.
Bless them in their new home. Though we will miss them, we know that your love goes with them and binds us together across the miles.
We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Arvid and Barbara, we love you and we will miss you, and God bless you. I hope that you will join us in giving them your personal greeting after the service. They'll be waiting for us out here along with the need. For now, though, I'm going to turn it over to Jeannie to benedict us out of here.
Receive now this benediction. Bear witness to the love of God in this world, so that those to whom love is a stranger will find in you generous friends. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.